What's going on, gardeners? It's Saturday, August 14th, and today I'm going to be doing something that I never thought would be possible here on the southeastern coast of North Carolina, and that is harvest some fully pollinated figs.
If you're new to the channel, please consider subscribing and hitting the bell to receive new video notifications, and check out our Amazon storefront and Spread Shop in the video description for a list of the gardening products I use and awesome custom-designed apparel and other gear. Your support is greatly appreciated.
Fig trees are absolutely amazing. The only way that figs can become pollinated and therefore generate viable seed for reproduction is through a process called mutualism, using a little itty-bitty tiny wasp called the Blastophagia scenes that colonizes male fig trees. Long story short, the male fig tree colonizes the wasp. The female wasps emerged covered in pollen. They fly into the female figs. They drag in that pollen, and then they pollinate the fig. I've been discussing this process in detail recently, and I'll make sure to link to a video above, because right now I am neck deep in a fig hand pollination experiment. It's a miracle of nature how the fig wasp works, so it's really worth your time watching if you're into that sort of thing. Long story short, the fig wasp is endemic to the Mediterranean. However, about 125 years ago, some farmers were able to successfully colonize the wasp in certain areas of California for the purpose of growing Smyrna variety figs. Unless you live in those choice pockets of California that have maintained the wasp for over a century, you don't have the fig wasp, so that means you cannot have naturally pollinated figs. That also means you can only grow figs that have a mutated persistent gene called a common fig or a parthenocarpic fig, which means the female figs will ripen on the tree without pollination. All of the figs that I have behind me that fruit for me have this genetic mutation. It's very rare in nature. You may be thinking to yourself, if so many varieties of figs can fruit without pollination, what's the point? Why are you making this video? Well, that's because fig pollination, called caprification, has a dramatic effect on the fig fruit itself. It makes them larger, it usually makes the interiors a darker red color, it improves the fruit quality, and it also increases the number of seeds or endocarps inside of the fig. So it has a dramatic change to that fig, and that's why I'm making this video. I want to see exactly how different these figs are compared to the normal unpollinated common figs that I'm used to eating. And the reason why that's important to me is because I developed such an easy method of hand pollinating figs, which I will link to above with my fig breeding experiment, that it's so easy to just go around and collect and inject the pollen that if it makes such a dramatic difference to the flavor, I may do it just because I can do hundreds of them within a few minutes pretty easily now. It may be worth my time. The first variety that I want to try is a newly discovered seedling that was only discovered a few years ago growing in the wild in California, and it's been called Meteorito. Now, nobody knows for 100% certain if this is a common fig or if this is a Smyrna fig that requires pollination. This is my tree's second season. Last year, it dropped 100% of its crop, which is consistent with a Smyrna variety that requires pollination. However, what I'm starting to find is that these new seedlings that are being found in California or in the Mediterranean, sometimes they need a few years to adapt to a new climate outside of those perfect California or Mediterranean growing conditions, and they may adjust if they're carrying that persistent gene. Now, right here in this yellow organza bag, I have a Meteorito fig that I hand pollinated, and it did swell, and it's pretty much ripe. So I'm going to pick that, and we're going to try that and taste it to see if it's better than what I'm usually used to. However, what I am seeing over here is that these unpollinated figs that aren't bagged, they're starting to color up, which they did not do last year, which is a good sign. It may mean that these are common. However, I'm also seeing that some of the unpollinated ones are shriveling up after they've colored up. So I really don't know what to think about this fig yet. Like, this one's colored up, but the other ones didn't look like this. It looks like it is attempting to ripen. So I think this is probably a common fig. Let me taste it. Very latexy and sap-like in there. I think that this is a common fig that just is going to take a couple years to adapt. However, I can't say for sure, so don't quote me on that. In the meantime, I'm going to pick off this pollinated fig, which is setting without issue. And here you can see what this fig looks like. It has a pretty, I would say a medium-sized eye. It seems fairly pest resistant, and it's handling my humidity really well. It is a beautiful fig. Then over here, I'm so excited to say I have a ripe white Madeira number one, and this is one of the figs that I hand pollinated as part of my hand pollination experiment. It looks like it has a beautiful drop of honey coming out of the eye there. And this fig right here looks like a total stunner. It's actually dripping some fig honey from the eye. I almost never get a fig of such high quality, and I've never had one of these caprified. This is typically a white Madeira number one, maybe one of my favorite figs ever. So pollinated, I can't wait to see what this looks like. So this is my first white Madeira number one of the year, and it is caprified. And it's pretty small at 28 grams. I'm sure it'll get larger as the season progresses. Then this is the Meteorito at 37 grams. I'm so excited for this. I've always wanted to know if this pollination would make my figs taste better. Oh, wow. Look at that fig right there. I never get a fig that looks this good here in North Carolina. It's so rare. Honestly, this fig probably could have used a hang for another day or two, but it's going to rain here for about a week and a half straight with these two tropical storms coming. Now let's see this. Ooh, this white Madeira number one looks so good. And this is the first one of the season. Usually it takes a tree a little while to get going, but this is very impressive. Here's the Meteorito in all its glory. And here's the white Madeira number one. This might be the most excited I've ever been to taste a fig. I cannot wait to see what these taste like. They just look perfect. So first is the Meteorito. Wow. That is a spectacular fig. It had a little bit of that grassy aftertaste that's common when you pick a fig that is a day or two underripe. So if this was another day or two ripened, this fig would have been an absolute knockout. But I would say this has a berry cherry tone, very cherry-like, just a delicious, silky, smooth interior. This right here, I hope so badly that this is a common fig, because this fig, this Meteorito, has the potential to be absolutely fantastic. For the sake of science, I had to harvest a whole bunch of seeds out of this, out of these two white Madeira halves that I actually have soaking in peroxide in this bowl behind me as part of my fig harvesting experiment. So it messed up the interior a little bit, but I should still be able to get an awesome taste of this wonderful fig. Mmm. Oh, wow. This might be the best fig I've ever had in my entire life. I'm just going to come out and say it. That was absolutely incredible. That tasted like strawberry shortcake. That is unbelievable. I think the Meteorito probably would have been up there had I let it ripen longer. This white Madeira just happens to be perfectly ripe. And I'm getting this result with this mind-blowing fig right here in some of the worst conditions here in humid, wet, coastal North Carolina. I can't imagine what you folks in California get that have both the dry Mediterranean summers, low humidity, and the wasp. It must be absolutely mind-blowing, because I honestly don't know how anything could get any better tasting than that white Madeira number one right there. That is absolutely incredible. Usually I give Dale his own spotlight, but these figs are so good that I actually want to eat them on camera with him. He is drooling up a storm in anticipation. Buddy, this is the Meteorito. Be gentle. Gentle. Oh, you're making such a mess. Oh. Mmm. How good is that, Dale? That is so good. That tastes like a perfectly ripe Bing cherry. So I can only imagine what it would be like if I would have let it ripen for another day or two. Back to the white Oh, that white Madeira number one is so good. It is absolutely unbelievable. It tastes like strawberry shortcake with strawberry pancake syrup on it. It's honestly, I don't even, Dale is literally licking the plate. Look at this. He's licking the plate. Now I gotta scrub all your drool off my plate. That's how good these figs are. Absolutely incredible. Oh, buddy. So after those two figs that I just ate, would I recommend hand pollinating as many figs as possible in order to improve the quality of the figs themselves? Absolutely, 100%, without a doubt, yes. Provided you use that hand pollination method that I came up with in my fig breeding experiment, using a hypodermic needle as a source of injecting a pollen solution. Otherwise, it would be far too much work. Making that pollen solution really made the job easy, and you can probably inject hundreds of figs over the course of 10 to 15 minutes if you have enough pollen. And again, I'm going to link to above this playlist that I'm putting together all about fig breeding. I recommend you follow along with the experiment if you're really into figs. It should be interesting. Now, I know that I wasn't able to do a direct comparison between a pollinated fig and an unpollinated fig to see how much the caprification process really improved the quality. However, I will try to do that side by side later in the season as more and more of my figs begin to ripen. Most of the figs that I hand pollinated are later season varieties, so they're not going to be ripe for me for a couple more weeks yet. But as my supply increases, I hope to have more of a comparison on this caprification at a later date. So everybody, I sure hope you enjoyed today's video. If you found it helpful, please make sure to hit that like button. And if you haven't already subscribed to the channel, please subscribe for future updates and more videos like these. If you're curious about any of the products that I use in my garden, they are all linked in my Amazon storefront down in the video description. If you'd like to support the channel by purchasing any custom-made merchandise, that's linked in my Spread Shop in the video description. So thank you all again so much for watching, and I hope to see all of you again on the next video.